Hey guys, I know I love french fries. I'm gonna show you how to make 10 different styles of french fries today. Cottage fries, potato wedges, steak cuts, Belgian style, crinkle cuts, waffle fries, palm souffle, shoestring, curly fries. Just to end this with a bang, the potato tornado. Let's get started. Up first, cottage fries. What we are going to start with are the herbs. Today I'm using a tablespoon of parsley, a teaspoon of lovely rosemary. Rosemary tends to be very strong and sort of aggressive in flavor, so I really want to use just a very mild amount. Granulated garlic, about a half teaspoon, about 2 teaspoons of salt, 2 tablespoons of Parmesan cheese, or as much as you'd like. 1/4 cup of neutral oil. We're just going to combine these ingredients basically to incorporate everything, almost like a vinaigrette. I have 1 pound of baby Yukon potatoes, and I'm going to use this special crinkle knife. So I'm looking at about 1/4 inch. I love Yukon potatoes. I think that they have a really nice color and flavor to them. We're gonna get these cottage fries tossed. The name cottage fry actually comes from the shingles of a roof or a cottage. And what I'm looking for is for these cottage fries to develop a slight crust on them. And so the Parmesan cheese will give us that crust. Today I'm using a half sheet pan. And I just wanna take a little bit of grapeseed oil, toss the potatoes on, definitely use a lot of that oil that's left in there. These cottage fries are going to go into a 375 degree oven for about 30 to 35 minutes. Going to want to flip these about halfway through to really ensure that we're getting a beautiful crust on these potatoes. Awesome. It's all about these little ones that get stuck, right? This is why I did not use parchment paper. This right here, this is going to be a really crispy potato. I mean, that right, this golden brown color, it's like unmatched. Hit it with just a little bit more love, a little more Parmesan cheese at the end. Really drive home some salt, some flavor. Cottage fries, what can I say? They are delicious, they're simple. It took 30 minutes. Wow, nothing better than fried potato. Moving on to potato wedge. We are using a russet potato for this potato wedge. What I wanna do is actually salt some ice water to leach out some of the starch in this potato. About 1 teaspoon of kosher salt. And I just wanna whisk those together just to make sure the salt is dissolved. That's the hardest part of this recipe. Mainly I'm using these because of the size. Russets tend to be fairly large. Start by cutting this in half. What that's going to do is actually give me a sturdy base to work with. And from here, I'll cut this into thirds. So I'm just tilting my knife slightly parallel to the cutting board and slicing down towards the center of the potato to create this sort of wedge effect. So we want to soak these potatoes for about 20 minutes. Soaking these potatoes in ice water is going to leach out some of the starch, and it's also going to put salt into the potato. So these have been soaking for 20 minutes. I'm going to transfer them to a new bowl. So I will season these potato wedges with 2 teaspoons of seasoned salt and about 1/4 cup of neutral oil. And so I'm going to lay these to roast on a sheet pan. I want to create enough space so that they're not sort of sweating on top of each other. I really want to allow enough space and airflow between these potatoes. I'm going to roast these potatoes in the oven about 375 for 40 minutes. I'm so excited about these potato wedges. I just think simple cooking is so beautiful. This is a very rustic approach to a potato. This probably takes one of the least amount of times to create. So for me, I'm plating this on just a beautiful sheet pan. With cooking it at a high temperature, it roasts on the outside and sort of steams on the inside. So you kind of have this almost like baked potato texture in the middle with this golden brown delicious texture on the outside. Super yummy. Let's get started with steak cut. Russet potato. What I want to do is essentially slice these about 1 inch to create some match sticks, right? Or a baton if you're a fancy French chef. And I'm going to soak these in warm salted water. So first step would be salt the warm water. So we're gonna season at the end and we're seasoning at the beginning as well. Done. When you're approaching anything that does not have a flat surface, it's gonna be really important to create that flat surface. Square this potato off. 1/2 inch lengthwise. So squaring off the potato will allow us to have even planks. And then I want to run my knife and create sort of 1/2 inch thick going the opposite direction. We're just gonna sort of soak in the salt water for about 20, 30 minutes. Really what I'm looking for and how I know they're ready, ultimately, is the potatoes become very pliable, right? The salt helps break down the starch in the potato, and a lot of the starch has actually leached out into the bowl. So what I wanna do is drain off this water and place the potatoes onto a dry, clean towel. Because the next step is that they're going to go into the freezer. So I want these potatoes to be very dry so that no water freezes onto the potatoes so that when I fry them, there won't be too much water to oil reaction. I like to spray a little bit of nonstick spray over the top of my tray just so that they don't stick. These are gonna go into the freezer for about 45 minutes. When placing the fries into the oil, we have to be careful not to overcrowd your vessel. So these are going into a low heat fryer, about 325, and they will cook for about 4 or 5 minutes. So the first cook is really just to sort of cook the inside of the fry, and the second cook is really just to cook the outside. Fries have cooked at the low temperature for about 4 minutes. We're looking great, right? These are very cooked through. And now what I wanna do is actually go into a hot fryer at 375 for about 5 minutes. And we're looking for a beautiful golden brown texture. Oh yeah. Give it a little toss every couple minutes. Awesome, these look wonderful. They're beautifully golden brown. Gonna be the perfect accoutrement to a delicious ribeye steak. Use a little flaky salt for this one, yum. Now that I got those fryers out of the way, let's plate these with my steak. Picture it here. And I so happen to have some delicious béarnaise sauce right here. So, this is the best job ever. Just eat fries all day. Twist my arm. Moving on to Belgian style. I'm using Kennenbeck potato for these Belgian style fries. Same scenario. We are going to soak these potatoes in salted cool water. Make sure you whisk in a figure eight. Really makes the potato taste better. We want to cut flat edges on our potatoes so that you can peel the potato easily. So today I'm using a paring knife. You can totally use a peeler. Kennenbecks are one of my favorite potatoes. I use them quite often for fries. You know, they have a really amazing mouthfeel to them. Now we are going to slice these down and go about a half an inch. So I have these planks here and now I'm just going to slice the opposite direction. So now that we have our fries cut, we are going to soak these in cool water. Our fries have been removed from the salted water and they're very pliable, right? The texture is completely different than when we started with that raw potato. So now with this first cook, ultimately, what I want to do is basically just cook the inside of the potato, right? These Belgian style fries are gonna be a twice cooked potato. So first in low heat, about 325, 4 or 5 minutes, and then on a high heat, about 365 for 4 or 5 minutes as well. We want to allow them to rest for about 30 minutes just to really allow the temperature of the potato to come down and allow the oil to really sink into that potato. Now that our fries have cooled a bit, I'm going to go into the high temperature fryer. And really this is just a few minutes just to get a really nice golden brown crust on the outside. Let's see how we are looking here with our Belgian fries. Yes, nice, love this. This is one of my favorite style of fries. These are like super fluffy on the inside and very crunchy on the outside. And using those Kennenbeck potatoes, it's perfect for this application. You definitely want to season your fries, or any fried food for that matter, right away, because while they're hot, the oil's really gonna stick to the fries. Love some kipi mayo to create the perfect bite every time, every fry. That'll work. Next up, crinkle cut. This is a Kennenbeck potato, and we want to peel the Kennenbeck potato. Kennenbecks are really good about staying sturdy and then they get really crispy on the outside. So I'm going to want to cut these Kennenbeck potatoes into planks first and then cutting to about a half an inch thick. After I cut my potatoes into half an inch planks, I will use a crinkle cut knife to create that sort of iconic crinkle. So our crinkle cut fries are going into very chilled water with a little bit of ice, and it actually our soak becomes what I'm going to blanch or sort of poach these potatoes in. It's a twice cooked preparation on these, so I'll bring these potatoes up to a simmer and pull out, give them a cool, and go into the fry. So now that our potatoes are blanched, what I want to do is remove them from the hot water. These are in here for about 4 or 5 minutes, and they're going to be very delicate, so be careful. Since they're so delicate, I'm actually just going to lift my towel and drop into the fryer. All right, let's do this. Fine salt is going into the crinkle cut fries. Crinkle cut into my to-go box. Look at that. A little beaut. She's a beaut. This is a fry for me. 100%. I love the grooves and how it sort of captures the sauce, the fine salt. This is like the fry that you want to eat with a cheeseburger. Let's try out the waffle. For this, we are using a mandolin and Yukon gold potatoes. Go ahead and slice a few off that are sort of throwaway fries because we want them all to be around the same size. So the first few will be a little bit small. You're just going to do sort of this crosshatch motion by turning your potato quarter. And you want to slice in a sort of clockwise rotation to achieve a very flat surface. These are about an eighth of an inch thick and very waffly. I'm going to fry for about 5 minutes. Since they're so thin, I'm actually not gonna do a double cook on these ones. Should cook fairly quickly. Waffle fries are getting pretty crispy here. We're getting some coloration. Frying in batches is going to give us and allow us to really control the temperature and the coloration on our waffle fries. If we were to jam so many potatoes in here, they would all really stick together. And I'm just gonna lay these on a wire rack to allow the oil to drain. I like to use a nice fine salt for these because they're so delicate and they're a little bit thin. So I don't want a big flaky salt. I really want that salt to really penetrate. And now I will dust with a bit of seasoned salt, which is one of my favorites. So our waffle fries are complete and I'm going to dip these into a special secret sauce, sort of Thousand Island vibe. Yum. Super delicious. Really light, delicate, very airy texture. Time for the difficult one, the pomme souffle. We are using a Yukon gold potato, voila, and a mandolin. You want to place your mandolin on the thinnest setting. So you want to make sure that you have a very sharp mandolin. So we have thin sliced potato. It's important to have two slices that are the same size to create that symmetry between the potatoes for the puff. So I'm gonna dust one side with cornstarch. The potatoes actually have a lot of natural starch content on them. So ultimately I just wanna coax a bit of that out with some cornstarch and use the egg white as a sort of protein structure to bind these potatoes together. So after we have adhered the two slices of potato together, we will begin to slice with our ring mold. This is achieved simply by applying pressure over top and pressing down gently, sort of punching out the center. So now that we have our shapes complete, these are ready to fry. We're gonna cook this at 325 for about 5 minutes. You want to coax the oil on and around and really baste these. You know, this is a technique that takes some time and it really takes a lot of care. If you're making pomme souffle, like this is all you're doing. The reality is sometimes these potatoes don't puff. You know, you got yourself some snacks while you wait. You get this really cool sort of puff action, and the air has been trapped in between those two layers of potato. And so the starch acts as sort of a binder, and the egg white acts as a sort of like glue. All right, little pomme souffle babies, a little fine salt. This is something I would serve like as an amuse-bouche if I had friends over. It's like such a delicate bite. Obviously it takes a lot of time. You're not trying to make like 100 pomme souffle. This is like that showstopper. You serve a little caviar on top. It's like the perfect tiny little bite to make your mouth happy. That texture of a pomme souffle is unparalleled. Time to make our tiny friend the shoestring fry. Shoestring fries. Shoestring. Enter the mandolin. What I like to do is approach this sort of at a 45 degree angle, and I will apply pressure in a sort of downward motion. shoestring potatoes are complete. What I will use is a sort of cool salted water. We're gonna soak these fries for about 20 minutes. You wanna get these fries as dry as possible because we want to fry these at 365 for about 4 or 5 minutes. You definitely want to make sure that we are allowing that oil to flow in and around the potatoes, because when they're this thin, they can tend to actually stick and clump together. Oh yeah. I love shoestring fries with fresh garlic. A great tip when slicing garlic or chopping garlic, just run it over a microplane. Gives it amazing flavor. A little Dijon toss, a little fresh garlic, fresh parsley, some fine salt. I mean, no need to dip. You can if you want, but these are already pretty flavored. Wow.
Moving on,
moving on to the curly fry. I have Yukon Gold potato. I have a spiralizer, and I also have a set of scissors. You wanna apply a really good amount of pressure when slicing these potatoes. Don't want a potato that's too large. A nice medium-sized Yukon Gold potato is gonna be great. After we have all of our potatoes sliced, so cool, I'm going to place these into warm salted water. So we're just gonna cut these down to about 3 or 4 inch size pieces. These potatoes are gonna soak for about 20 minutes. Now for our batter. I like to use sweet paprika. I use a smoked paprika, a little bit of granulated garlic, and some onion powder. A half a cup of all-purpose flour, 1 cup of water, and about 2 teaspoons of salt. This you wanna whisk together until fully combined. And then there's the fun part. Get to get messy. Meow. Using my best tools I have. We are gonna drop these in a 365 degree oil for about 8 minutes. Now, wow, these look amazing. Never do I have to go through a fast food drive-thru again. Yes. I'm going double dip. Little mayo, little catch. For me, it's the craveable texture around the outside. When we add in those like aromatics like garlic and onion and paprika, you really get this really phenomenal flavor on these curly fries. Last but not least, the potato tornado. This is going to require a bit of equipment here. I've created this setup using an industrial size potato chip clip, or a grip clip, some might call. And essentially what that's going to do is hold down this piece of beautiful machinery called a tornadoizer. What I wanna do is actually perforate this potato by poking a small hole down the middle, removing the skewer. So essentially I'm just going to line up the skewer with the perforation in the potato that I've already made. You really wanna get in there and use your muscle to push to create the right size and slices of this potato. It's creating these ribbons. I'm just sort of helping it along by giving it a quarter turn ever so often. I want this to have somewhere to stick onto, right? So I'm gonna take the point of the skewer and I'm gonna fold over a piece of the potato, essentially just holding it in place. So from here, what I want to do is exactly mimic the other side. And here we have our potato tornado. Looks so cool. So now I'm going to place my potato tornado in an ice bath for about 20 minutes. These have soaked. I'm going to make my seasoning sort of dredge for this potato tornado because I really want to achieve this awesome texture around the outside. For this dry mix, we're gonna use salt and pepper, paprika, and AP flour. I like to sift my dry ingredients just to equally disperse them, really making sure that you get in the grooves and you're seasoning the entire potato. I've actually swapped fryers. I have a larger fryer now because these are huge. Drop this in at an angle. All right, and now we wait. Okay, we're looking good. Nice, delicious GBD. Golden brown and delicious. Look at that, it's a potato tornado. I don't even need a plate for this, but first I will grab my QP mayo, my beloved. My first potato tornado experience. Wow, it has such an interesting texture. It's like all of your potato chips on one skewer for convenience. Makes sense why it's a street fair favorite. Thanks for sticking with me through all of these recipes. It's been a journey. Tell me which one's your favorite. Tell me which ones that you make at home, and send pics.